So what are y'all looking for on this show?
Artistry, authenticity, individuality.
What is the purpose of Rhythm and Flow?
Giving an opportunity, a new opportunity.
These ops ain't lit. Mommy.
How you?
What's going on, man?
How you?
Love and respect.
What's the word?
Good to see you, man.
Well, we here to talk Rhythm and Flow. What made you two want to be judges on Rhythm and Flow?
When it was presented to me, Chance and Cardi was already, you know, a part of the package, and I thought us three would make a very diverse group and three different perspectives on how to build and construct, you know, the next superstar of the generation.
It's like, why not jump at the opportunity, so.
Yeah. Well, you know, hip-hop is different from other genres of music, so you think hip-hop would accept an artist who came up via a competition reality show? Well,
definitely. As long as you're authentic, as long as you're true to your real story.
That's all it takes.
Has internet fame replaced like true clout and success?
Clout is something fictitious.
Clout is already clout.
Hold on, let me rephrase that then. Has internet fame and clout replaced true success?
People who can't, who haven't achieved that true success, they want to celebrate what they can.
Right.
Man, and what can they celebrate until they get to, you know, true success?
So what are y'all looking for on this show then?
Artistry, authenticity, individuality, the same way Chance is in his music, I am in my music, and Cardi is in hers. Each of our presentations are very unique to who we are. And we're looking for the next generation's version of that.
How does that affect the judging, though? Because the generations are different. So you might see something in an artist that Chance and Cardi don't see. Chance and Cardi might see something that you don't see.
The way that the competition is laid out is very specific challenges each day. You can't really judge somebody on just how good their song is. Right. Every part of you as an artist has to be like, you know, obviously creative, but also business-minded, managing yourself. How much did you step out of your comfort zone? How much of yourself did you present for this specific? Exactly, and the ones that shine through that are the people that are built for this shit.
When it comes to critique, back in the day, it used to be just magazines, a few radio personalities. Now people don't like your album. It could be a bunch of people trolling you on social media.
Yeah.
How do you think that will affect the contestants on this show?
Well, it makes it interactive. The internet as a whole is kind of made hip-hop a direct-to-consumer industry, where before you had to go through different... You had to circumvent your way through to get to a place where you could reach your fans or you could reach the consumer. Now you can dive right to them once you put it up.
That shit can hurt too, though. They don't give nothing no time.
There can be no good without bad, no bad without good. You know what I mean? It's a fair exchange.
How did that affect y'all as artists when y'all put out music?
I came into the game like when YouTube was getting really big. I'm used to like understanding commentary on a different level than I think people that release music before or after me. I think it's a learning experience as we go on, just figuring out how to directly, you know, interact with our fans, right, how to accept information in, how much you want to put yourself out there.
How to engage. Everybody want an individual piece of their favorite artist. They want to have an experience with them that only they had. And if you got tens of millions of fans, how many unique experiences can you offer each of them?
That's real.
You dig what I'm saying? So I think that's the balance, man. But ain't nothing like a star with a story.
Word.
Like for instance, DMX, a star with a story, a phenomenal story.
Absolutely.
For DMX to actually be able to conceptualize what his story is in such a way where he can present it with such clarity. And he ain't got to use word.
Word.
He meant that. Yeah. You dig what I'm saying? Yeah. He meant that shit. And I think every artist has their own way of conveying those types of messages. It's just how they choose to bring it out. That's what we're here for.
And as I say, with a show like this, people can fall in love with the story even more so than the talent. So when you look at hip-hop nowadays, how important is the music?
I think everything is based on narratives. Absolutely. Everything that we get presented in terms of reality TV, commercials, new content, old content, the way that they give it to you is supposed to ride along a narrative. So it's the same thing with music.
Okay, I think music is always the tool. You know what I mean? It's the instrument. Like, you could fill the Staples Center up with Kobe's, Michael's, and LeBron's, shit, when they get to the floor, if it ain't no ball, what they gonna do?
That's real.
You know what I mean? So I think music is the ball.
Word.
You know what I mean? What you able to do with the ball, you know what I'm saying? That's gonna dictate, you know, how your legacy is lived.
How harsh were y'all on the contestants on this show?
Harsh?
Honest.
I feel like they made me Simon. When niggas had to go, it was like, all right, Chance. Well, I said,
you chose
me.
To be Simon.
You the Simon?
In a lot of cases, I'm the last person to talk. It's right. Like, yeah, you gotta go.
Yeah, he have a real knife to the throat kind of. You know what I mean?
Damn, Chance, they not gonna expect that.
I'm more of a bullet to the back of the head kind of guy. Listen, we all got somewhere to be, man. Let's go get this over with, man.
Quick.
We owe them honesty.
Yeah.
Because it's something that each person is meant to be doing. It's a art, a talent, a gift that they have inside of them, a purpose that they were sent here on this earth to complete. And this ain't it. So let's get you out of here so you can get back to doing what you need. You can find your real passion.
So how much stock should an artist put in criticism?
They should put probably, I say, zero into it.
It's just like, I could say, hey, listen, an artist should take all criticism extra serious. I could say that, but when you get the suggestion, man, maybe this ain't for you. You know, if your mind says, well, maybe it ain't for me.
Right.
Then, I mean, that's it, you know? That's a telltale sign right now, this shit ain't for you. Man, if your first mind will, well, fuck you, man. Yeah, hey, man, that between me and the universe. Get out of our business, you know? You ain't the judge and jury of my destiny. Now, if that's your first mind, then you probably gonna figure it out along the way.
Right.
I'm not even gonna ask T.I. this, I'm gonna ask you, Chance. Was there ever a point where somebody told you you couldn't make it and you believed him? Because I know he believes in himself 100% all the time.
I think I doubted myself.
Yeah.
But I don't think I ever listened to other people's doubts and was like, you know what, that nigga's right. Like, yeah. It's like...
What made you doubt yourself?
I feel like when you're at a certain level, it's like, I just want to get here. And you feel like once you get here, then it's like, you just chill. But it's like, it's a constant climb. When I was younger, I just used to think, I'm never going to make it to that space. And I got past that space and just learned that I have to keep going, you know what I mean?
Now, there was a period after I'm Serious.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm Serious didn't do well, did you doubt yourself?
It was an adjustment. It was a pivot. My only problem early on was enough people didn't hear my music.
Mm.
You see what I'm saying? As soon as a motherfucker heard my shit, I had him. You know what I'm saying? So I seen at that point, okay, well, I just need to get this motherfucker out more. I mean, I think I had to kind of establish myself as a force in certain extracurricular activities before, you know, the music could actually be taken seriously. You have to kind of say, man, am I tripping? Is it me? Sooner or later, that voice kick in and say, man, fuck that, keep going.
Word.
And shit.
Y'all both describe very traditional ways of getting on, though. Like, Riverman Flow is a non-traditional way to get on. So it makes me wonder, is there a traditional way to get on nowadays, or are those days gone?
I personally think those days are gone. Myself, Tip, and Cardi all got on in very unconventional ways. I think the main difference between this show and every other show, it's nobody on the show that's weak. Like, it's nobody on the show that's trash.
That's
to
true.
Be on our show, like a lot of other shows, I'm not gonna say the names, but they spend the whole first 2 weeks giving you laughs at how bad people are at this craft.
It's good content, though.
It's great content, but we serious.
The people who we put together in this competition, they have so many different applications of skill. It's
right.
Such a diverse group.
Yeah.
I'm proud. I can't wait for y'all to see it.
And basically, it's encouraging people to stay independent, right?
My understanding of all the other shows that are talent competitions is like they put you in a position to be stuck with them. For one, like you said, we're going to hook up all these people with the right people they need to know. We're going to put these people in front of 100 million plus viewers. And at the end, we need to give them the tools so that they, not just somebody that was on that show that one time, that they got the contacts that they need and the capital that they need to rent out this studio that I use all the time and mm-hmm. come in here and make the project that they want to.
When you look at somebody like Chance Tip, do you think you'd have achieved the level of success you did if you would have stayed independent instead of going with a major?
I probably couldn't have done as much as fast. Once you hit 250,000 sales independent, you playing with house money now.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, as you get your checks, man, you can invest in videos and tours and, you know, like Tech N9ne, if you recall.
Yeah,
Tech N9ne
yeah.
is a perfect example of that.
Definitely.
Like Tech N9ne went gold a few times, you know what I'm saying, independently. And his business acumen has been superlative.
You know he owns all the tour buses that everybody uses.
Yes.
Everybody rents their tour buses from Tech N9ne. That's what I'm trying to get on with my independent money. I'm trying to get right back
I
in
there. I think
it.
That definitely has to be acknowledged and considered as one of the best entrepreneurial efforts of this generation.
You don't regret not signing with a major at all? You ever say to yourself, man, this shit is too tough doing it on my own?
I definitely be saying this shit is too tough all the time. I think I'm just in a different position now. Like, I done talked so much shit about that shit. I could never, never sign a deal.
I'm stuck in your position.
They damn near don't want me now.
The good thing about being independent, all the expenses come through you. And it's all right to audit.
Yeah, it's good
to audit. It's all right to audit, you know what I'm saying? That's fair business practice.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? If somebody said that, you know, your statement says $575,000 before the longevity of this deal runs up, let me just see that we got everything accurate. And if you come up with an extra $200,000 because they made mistakes and didn't catch certain things, then that's to your advantage.
What would y'all have done with $250,000 when y'all first started?
Lost it instantly.
I'd have probably put it in the wrong, I'd have invested in the wrong shit.
I would have let somebody convince me.
I'd have been right back to my old shit.
Don't more in the trap, man.
I mean, it's the easiest, most available thing to, you know what I'm saying, to kind of, to give you a good ROI. Those margins are, you know, kind of hard to beat.
Let's talk about the culture a little bit, because this is a show about the culture. Is the code of the culture broken, or has it been redefined?
I low-key hate the word culture, yo.
Really?
Think culture just invited everybody else into our shit.
Ooh, expound on that. I like that.
I think everybody, like, we start talking about culture vultures and we're talking about hip-hop as a culture, then it allows everybody to feel like it's something that's a research-based thing. It's like, if I know about the five pillars of hip-hop or I know the albums that came out last summer, I'm fit to decide what is it or isn't it. I'm fully a part of the culture now because I know about it.
The code of the culture has been defiled. We haven't protected it. I think a lot of personal gain has kind of incentivized people to turn a blind eye to things that could inevitably hurt, harm, or potentially destroy. You're gonna have to stand up for it if you believe in it. And if not, it's gonna get handled. We're allowing the culture to get handled right now.
Hip hop is like an extension of black culture. So everybody can't live black culture.
Mm-mm.
I don't think everybody can commentate on black culture.
Mm.
Anybody that's using it to sell more stuff or to seem more knowledgeable of cultures outside of their own, they're exploiting it. But if you listen to rap and you like rap, coolio.
Look, I listen to Eminem and I love Eminem. One of the greatest lyricists known to man, but I can't really identify with the things that he's talking about.
Absolutely.
The way that, you know,
somebody who wants to kill a mom would identify with it.
Yes. I mean, the way Crazy White Boy came,
you know
what I'm saying? No matter how much I love, appreciate, and admire his skill set, I'll never really, really be able to identify with the feeling that he's describing in his songs. And I think that's the same way, you know, other guys would feel about Tupac.
Mm-hmm.
You dig what I'm saying? You know, white guys love Tupac, but as much as they appreciate and admire his passion and his contribution, they'll never know what it was like. They can never really, like, relate completely to what he embodies.
Absolutely.
Both are fine.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Both are fine. It's great that we've transcended these racial divides and age and generational and all that stuff. That's phenomenal. I think that's what the culture was meant to do, bring us together, make us focus on the things that we have in common more than we do the things that tear us apart. Music and weed, like that, you know what I'm saying? Like, those are the things. A brother from the nation and a Klansman can sit down and smoke a joint together.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Absolutely.
Ain't nobody really, like, you know, all right, man, I don't fuck with you, you don't fuck with me, but we gonna, it's one joint here. We both smoke. Like, that's where growth and evolution come from.
I feel like it'd be easier for a reformed Klansman to work with the Brotherhood than it would be for a reformed NOY to get into the Klan. You know what I'm saying?
But, like, see, that's the thing, though.
Because we're so accepting of people.
That's what I'm saying.
We're so forgiving and accepting of people. That's blackness,
though. When Lil Nas X was trying to get his country song out. Like, still to this day, do you think anybody like classifies him as a country artist?
Absolutely
or that
not.
Song is
nah.
It's like novelty. Any other counterpart on the same side trying to do that in hip hop, it's like there's no like litmus test to be.
You mean the Post
Malone
black
enough
fit.
To be? Yeah. I'm just saying anybody.
Yeah.
Post Malone is my dude. Also,
I mean, I love his music, but you, I mean, you can't tell me that ain't Future.
Yeah,
you know
no,
what I'm saying? There's some Future in there.
I don't know if black people are
he
too
does well, but you know, let's just call it what it is.
When it comes to hip hop, I don't know if black people are too accepting or if we don't have no choice because
that's
we don't got
point.
No control.
That's the point that I'm making.
So if they prop up a Vanilla Ice or
we don't create the culture.
Because if we say the shit don't go, it don't go.
But we not the number one consumers of hip hop.
Yeah, what about all them white people in the Midwest and
listen, man. We are the thermostat, not the thermometer.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? Mm. If we say, hell no, that ain't it. Then, you know, all of those other white guys and white ladies who love hip hop, who spend all their money on it, they gonna look and say, hey, you see that? They say, that ain't it. Nah, we can't, we gotta back up off this. We gotta back up off this. It's not authentic.
I've been saying Post Malone
like a fake,
for years.
It's like a fake Louis bag.
I like the Post Malone songs.
I
like the Post Malone songs.
I've been saying Post Malone
ain't
for years.
I love the song. I think they dope. I think he's now growing into a different level of artistry than it was when he first came out.
You know who's dope?
Oh.
Juice WRLD.
Juice WRLD is dope.
Juice WRLD got it on lock.
Juice WRLD is dope.
And he does multiple cultures and puts it into our culture, and everybody consumes it.
But here's the thing. We created most of those cultures anyway.
You're right.
Whether it's rock
created
and roll,
rock. Yeah, for sure.
Like R&B, like what didn't we create? What didn't come from black culture?
But will anybody classify him as an artist other than a rapper?
So do we accept hip-hop as pop culture?
Pop music is really just clean hip-hop.
Right.
Which clean hip-hop and crisp R&B, you know, up-tempo.
That shit better be crisp.
You
when
know
it
what I'm saying?
No, straight up. We get a lot of versions of stuff after it's already been hot. Like mm-hmm. the stuff that gets reproduced and mass produced is stuff that, like you said, we check the temperature and we like, this is hot. And then the industry over time gives us more and more versions of it and they refine it and refine it until it's right to be mass produced.
I feel like if it's dangerous, it's R&B. If it's safe and non-threatening, then it's pop. The things that white people are comfortable playing for their children.
Gotcha.
Like, that's usually what they call pop.
That's what I'm trying to make.
I'm
trying to get them dollars.
Let's keep it in the cultural conversation because I want to talk about street culture. Now, somebody comes on Riverman Flow, they get on that stage tip and they talk about all of this gangster stuff and all the guns they busted and X, Y, and Z. How do you handle that?
I can't really police nobody about what they saying and whether or not they did it. And like, bro, of course, I'm just gonna go, when you say it, do I believe you? If I believe you, then I'm gonna invest. You know, I'm gonna dial in. You know what I mean? It ain't gonna take me, it'll take me 2-3 songs later to what I actually start trying to call people from where you from and ask about you.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
He said he from hell.
Yeah,
oh, you ain't never seen him before?
But don't you think we might be too inviting? Cause you look at somebody like 6ix9ine. All these kids believed in him.
It ain't even
him. And we see that ain't what it is.
To be honest with you, man, bro did what the people who were around him allowed to be done.
Mm.
And that's what I mean by protecting the culture.
So should you allow somebody like that to make that kind of music?
You can't not let somebody say or do something. You just don't support it. Like, I can't rock with that, bro. I can't rock with that.
Chance, do you think it's too early for you and Cardi to be judges on a show like this? Because people would say, damn, y'all just started your dance up.
With everything that Cardi's been through, everything that she had to go through to make shit happen for herself, she's the perfect person, probably one of the most legitimate people to be a judge in a hip hop competition. Myself, I just offer a different, you know, viewpoint on what success is, on how much control you should have or what you should be looking for. What I'm really there for is to offer advice and to say, this is what I think you could have did better. This is what I would have did if I was in your situation.
Mm.
Tip, do you even need to do music anymore?
Music don't define me. Music does not define. It is my passion, not my purpose.
Word.
You dig what I'm saying? I love doing it, but it ain't because I have to do it. I love being able to do business. As a real estate developer, I have a multi-unit, a 200-unit mixed-use development that I'm about to break ground this year on Bankhead. That, to me, it satisfies a different part of my creative spirit. I don't want to focus on the things that I can do and everybody else have an opportunity to do the same thing, I'm gonna take the narrow path every time. Like opening a museum. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like I feel like that satisfied a different level of creativity for me just to be able to say, man, you know, I told our story in our voice before anyone else could come and exploit this story and tell it for us.
Well, my final question, what is the purpose of Rhythm and Flow?
It's giving an opportunity, a new opportunity that didn't exist before, to offer them that space to meet the people that they met and perform in front of all these viewers, also to grow, and then to obviously have a chance at, you know, winning the type of money that could really put together most of the stuff that you need as an artist.
This is an opportunity to develop the first user-generated hip-hop superstar phenomenon. Like, this is actually coming from, you know, the people who feel that they should be, you know, in that position. So whoever wins this competition, it's, you know, a long line of opinions that led to him or her being hoisted into that position and going home with a quarter mil.
It's like the watchers are investing into the artist.
Absolutely.
Word. All right, can't wait to see it, man. Chance.
Yeah. Always,
yes, sir. My brother.
Always.
Yes, sir.